afternoon. Thank you everybody for coming on this wonderful sunny afternoon in Salzburg. It's really my pleasure to introduce three speakers that I've invited to deliver papers around the theme of photography today. As you know, the exhibition is centered around this theme of punctum, a term coined by Roland Barthes in his book Camera Lucida. But the exhibition also is here to ask questions about what photography is today, as a medium, as an art form. As you might have seen on the poster, there's a phrase from Barthes saying that he was looking to find his ontological status. And I think it's an ongoing question, of course, but I hope that some of that conversation will be held today with a drooping microphone. And just a quick introduction to our three speakers, Boris Groys, Ruth Horak, and Friedrich Tietjen. I think it'll be an interesting mix of lectures given today from this sense of punctum in photography circulating into other spheres, as Boris will speak about. Then a sort of homage to analog photography, which is becoming obsolete, and then more questions into digitization and the image of the computer age that we're in now, the future teaching will deliver. So the order of events today, we're going to try and wrap everything up by six. Each person is going to deliver the talk for about 25 minutes or so, give or take, and one after the other. And then afterwards, we're going to open up for a discussion. So everyone's very welcome to get into the conversation if you have some questions. We'll save them for at the end of the three lectures. I think it's the most practical way to do it. And we'll have all three speakers come up and converse with you. And hopefully we won't need to use microphones at that stage. Okay, so without any further ado, I'll introduce Boris Groys for the first lecture. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Shams, for inviting me here. Nice to meet you. Okay, so in our time, photography has finally become an established art form, and not even an established art form, but in a certain way also a living one. The exhibitions of photography have lost a revolutionary avant-garde artists that still market the attacks against the traditional religious status painting, so characteristic for 60s and 70s of the last century. Today, photography does, in fact, do everything that painting did in the 19th century. Also, painting itself.
This microphone a little down here.
Yeah. It's better?
Yeah.
No? Yes. So, photography today does, in fact, do everything that painting did in the 19th century. Also, painting itself stopped doing it. So photography shows urban life, life in nature, people's faces, the naked bodies, the living environment, exotic cultures, wealth and fashion, misery and war. Accordingly, when we discuss the work of an individual photographer, we are usually concerned with its content, with the choices of the photographer, with photographer's attitude as object shown, as was usual in traditional art criticism before the rise of the avant-garde. So today, photography is mostly discussed in terms of 19th century discussion of painting. But still there is a certain discontent with photography. In fact, a very familiar discontent that never really went away. Namely, we ask ourselves, can the subjectivity of the artist be reduced to his or her choices and attitudes towards the things and events that constitute visible world of our common experience? Or maybe there is something invisible, hidden behind the source of the world, something that cannot be objectively, technically recorded and photographed, something maybe spiritual, maybe subjective, maybe essential, maybe ontologically hidden, that only the subjectivity of the artist could reveal. To deal with this question, I would like to turn to a relatively short text by Siegfried Krakauer from 1927, entitled Die Fotografie, The Photography. It is a well-known text, but I would like to refer to it nevertheless. As an example, Krakauer takes a photograph of his grandmother. That is a private photograph, a photograph of sentimental value, and observes that this photograph does not bring back memories of his grandmother as it should, but blocks them. His grandmother as a person, as an individual, as an inner being, is not disclosed by her photograph, but instead only her outward appearance is visible, which, however, through the fashion, is defined through the fashion of the times. So her clothes and makeup, so it seems impersonal and de-individualized. Krakauer writes, I quote, "We are contained in nothing, so soul is nothingness." Yeah? And the de-individualized, and photography collects fragments around this nothing. When my grandmother stood in front of the lens, she was present for a second in a special continuum offering itself to the lens. Yet instead of my grandmother, this outer aspect alone is immortalized. Not the person stands out in the photograph by the sum of what is to be subtracted from her. It destroys the person by portraying her, and if she were to coincide with it, she would not exist, end of quotation. So, for Krakauer, every photograph is merely, as he says, a general inventory of diverse fragments or details that lacks, however, an inner unity. Such a unity can only arise on the level of sense or meaning, and yet the meaning cannot be, by definition, be photographed, because the meaning, the sense, are invisible, a need, an interpretation to be made manifest. As a consequence, photography for Krakauer is merely a garbage can, he says, a phantom and a sign of death. Instead of vanquishing death, photography kills, for it captures only the body, the corpse, and negates the soul. The disintegration of images of memory in photography has a moral dimension for Krakauer. He writes, I quote again, "The meaning of images of memory is linked with the truth content, as far as they are embedded in uncontrolled sexual desire or sensual desire, they acquire an inherent demonic suggestiveness." Yeah, end of quotation. So it exactly is demonic nature that Krakauer diagnoses in photography, though he primarily connects his diagnosis with the spectral, as he puts it, unredeemed character of the photographic representation, it can be claimed that the connection lies somewhat deeper. Demonic sensual desire that is directed to the surface of the things is primarily linked with a certain ultimate season, with the working of the desiring unconscious. A simple click is now sufficient to create a picture. The camera is a machine of desire, of the unconscious. So camera as desiring machine, in a sense maybe in which Deleuze used this notion. It is therefore interesting to observe that Krakauer's strategy is repeated in all of its essential tendencies in the book, which belongs to those texts that play a key role in today's discussions of photography, that is Roland Barthes's book, Camera Lucida. From 1980. The notion of punctum is also taken from this text, obviously. Bart too takes private photographs, the photographs of his dead mother, so not grandmother, but mother, as an example, and tries to recognize her in these photographs, but he also doesn't succeed. The inner being, the true identity of his mother, once again escape photographic representation. Instead of his mother, Bart sees on these photographs, under her hand, the mere fashions of former times. Only on one photograph does Bart recognize his mother, but his photograph shows her as a child. That means a time in which Bart himself has no memories of his own, and so his imagination can be set free by this photograph. So there is a similarity, very close similarity between Krakow and Bart analysis, but at the same time, a substantial difference. And now I go to this difference. As you remember, Krakow looks on one image, on one photograph, and analyzes this photograph, trying to find out if this individual photograph gives him truth about his grandmother. For Krakow, a photograph is a unique, isolated photographic image. So he looks at the photographic image in the tradition of in a pictorial tradition, traditional looking at individual painting. Bart understands photography in a much more contemporary way, as a series of photographs, as a photographic archive. He acts already as a curator, displaying the archive of his mother's photographs, so that he was able to see the punctum, an individual photograph that belongs to this archive is not does not belong to it at the same time. That is related to his memories, but escapes him. In other words, punctum is not the quality of individual photograph. Punctum is produced by curating a photographic archive, by building a series, a field of comparison, in which a complicated play of inclusions and exclusions singles out the photograph that is included and excluded at the same time. So we should not think about punctum as it is described by Bart in any emotional terms. This image is specific and has this punctum not because it expresses more than any other photograph in the archive. It is also doesn't have a punctum because a receiver, a subject of contemplation, reads into this photograph something specific or acquires an emotional relationship to this particular photograph. The whole problem is purely logical one. So if I decide to display and to go one after another through the images of my mother, and I find this specific image of her before I was born, I come in a kind of logical contradiction. On one hand, it is my mother, so it is the same person. On the other hand, it is not my mother because it didn't produce me at the time at which photograph is taken. So in fact, I don't understand the logical status of the image. It is a part of the archive and not part of the archive at the same time. It is a point where my criterion of choice becomes contradictory. So that image begins to function for me as a punctum, as a point where the strategies of inclusion and exclusion begin to mix up and come into a strange interplay that I can't control anymore. That can happen not when I look at a decontextualized or the contextualized photograph, but only if I develop an attitude of a curator, so not of a producer and not of a spectator or a curator, towards photography. So we are trying to display photography of a certain kind. Only if I do that, I get the punctum at the end. So I come into the complicated, contradictory situation. The discourse on photography that was developed by Krakauer and Bart is very similar, in fact, to the interpretation of photography, cinema photography, in the famous text by Walter Benjamin, The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction. One can argue that in a certain way the aura he describes has the same structure as the structure of punctum. Aura for Benjamin is an inscription of a certain image into a context, into its here and now. So this here and now of a photographic image actually creates any image, but also a photographic image, creates its punctum, if you want, and creates its aura, if you want, if you use a different language. So the difference between traditional art and art of photography or cinema is, for Benjamin, a clear one. And it's very analogous to what Krakauer and Bart actually are writing. So if traditional art, sculpture, painting, have from the beginning some kind of inscription into here and now, an inscription into history, and then are removed from this original or artistic context by moving them into museum or exhibition, or by copying them. With photography, we can argue something opposite happens. Photography is originally a copy. Photography originally a copy, that means that photography originally has no soul. It is dead. It has no punctum, and it has no aura. But it doesn't mean automatically that it can't acquire it. A photography can acquire an aura by being put into a certain context. This context can be created by an archive, as Bart did it, or by a certain kind of narrative or description of a way in which this photograph is contextualized. So what actually happens in this exhibition is that every photograph gets a narrative. This narrative creates a content of this, a context of this photograph, and this context gives to this photograph an aura or a punctum. So it's not like this photograph is a punctum and the text explains why it is the case. The opposite happens. All these photographs have no punctum because no photograph has punctum and no photograph has aura. But aura and punctum are produced by a curatorial effort to contextualize this photograph in a certain kind of text, or through a certain kind of narrative, and a certain kind of display, where suddenly this photograph becomes to be problematic, to be logically, conceptually, or socially, or politically ambiguous and challenging. And in that case, we have this exhibition of punctum produced by Shepard in this case. Yeah. Okay, and I would like to conclude with the following short reflection, because, you know, during our talks, also yesterday, we gave time and again to the question of the internet. And what happens to digital photography in terms of ontology, and what happens to photography if it is shown in the internet? I would say that every photography that is shown in the internet automatically gets all and puncto.
Why?
Because the photograph gets an address. Through positioning of a photograph, individual photograph in the internet, you take it out of the area of topologically undisclosable and neutral circulation that is characteristic of the analog world. And you put it into the space in which every image has an address. So you not look at the image that comes to you as a copy, but you go to the address. And to go to the address is precisely how Benjamin describes a regional mode of functioning of art. You go to the artwork. Instead, the artwork is brought to you by copy industry or by exhibition industry. And what is interesting also about internet is not only the production of the photograph is controlled and only display photograph is controlled, but also spectatorship is controlled. If you look at a photograph or any image in a space of an exhibition, your gaze do not leave any trace on the surface of the image. That is actually, if you speak about ontology, that is ontological experience that creates actually the fiction of ontological difference between subject and object. Yeah. So subject is not an object, because if subject is related to an object, subject, our gaze here, but the subject is placed, leaves no trace on the surface of the object. It's not the case in the internet. If I access a certain photograph, my way to this photograph, the fact that I look at it, leaves traces in the internet, and also if you look at certain details in the internet, or the shift photograph in a certain way, all these operations leave traces. That means that the act of display in a lot of the sources, the spectatorship, begin to be traceable and begin to function as organic and punctum, producing. So it's quite clear what actually is the difference and what is actually is the logical status of punctum and aura. They have to do the surveillance. Yeah? Internet. Internet is before it was used by Google and so on. Internet is a machine of surveillance because internet was created to abolish the indeterminate circulation of copies and to put the circulation under control so that all the circulation begins to leave traces and can be retraced. So it is a huge machine of surveillance. And to be surveilled, to be able to be surveilled, is precisely what actually secular elimination is in Benjamin or punctum in part, is a retraceability. It is a possibility to return to the same circle space, to the same address. Yeah, something that is not possible in the analog world, obviously, but is possible in internet. The only problem is the internet, of course, it's not made for the human gaze. Yeah, it's a little big, and as a space, it's displaced. As it's too big for human gaze, it's too small for code, so it's not divine. So I would say it is made for non-human, post-human, as it's special to say today, for the post-human algorithmic gaze. So actually, it's a subject of the subject of contemplation internet is an algorithm. Now it is Google and the same, but a very different time that everybody, so every person, especially every art interested person, will have its own algorithm to go through the internet and to find logical paradoxes and contradiction that will bring this algorithm to stop and create this quantum radical experience. I think this time is not so far away.